William Morrow and Harper Audio present The Queen of Sugar Hill, a novel of Hattie McDaniel by ReShonda Tate, performed by Lynnette R. Freeman. For my grandmother Pearlie, who introduced me to Hattie and dared me to dream like her. What dreams we have, and how they fly like rosy clouds across the sky, of wealth, of fame, of sure success, of love that comes to cheer and bless, and how they wither, how they fade, the waning wealth, the jilting jade, the fame that for a moment gleams, then flies forever. Dreams, ah, dreams. Paul Laurence Dunbar. Part 1. Hedda Hopper's Hollywood. February 29th, 1940. Hello, everybody. Hedda Hopper reporting to you from Hollywood, that fabulous place where everyone wants to live but seldom does. Everybody, look over my shoulder as I write my column. We'll have news about famous people, okay? Let's go. It's Academy Awards time. Some of the greats are vying for that coveted statue, from Hollywood heartthrob Clark Gable to Judy Garland to Robert Donat. But all eyes are on Hattie McDaniel. Miss McDaniel, a negress, is up for Best Supporting Actress, the first member of her race to be so honored. I was on the scene as Miss McDaniel, full of smiles and gardenias and bosom, trundled into the venue. I believe everyone is delighted that Miss McDaniel, who gave such a superb performance as Mammy in Gone with the Wind, is up for an Academy Award. Will she or won't she make history tonight? The world is watching. Chapter 1. February, 1940. If my mama could see me now. I was a long way from the one-room wood-frame shack in Wichita, Kansas, where I was always singing a spin on a Negro spiritual or dancing the cakewalk with my three siblings. That's what we used to do to take our minds off the rumblings in our stomachs. Gone was the indescribable hunger I had back then, when I lived in a home haunted by my parents' memories of how they'd escaped slavery and their never-ending quest to give us a better life. I'd come into the world malnourished and destitute, and now, 46 years later, my story was about to be rewritten. I pushed aside thoughts of where I'd been and focused on where I now was, inside the sprawling ballroom of the Coconut Grove Club, basking in the atmosphere of the Black Tie Academy Awards dinner. I was overwhelmed by the smell of rose, jasmine, and most of all vanilla Chanel No. 5, the perfume every glamour girl in the room was wearing. The large ballroom was flanked by massive columns ornamented with white lilies cascading from the top. Gauzy beige curtains draped from the ceiling. Negro waiters in white jackets flowed back and forth with bottles of Lanson champagne and silver service trays perched over their shoulders. They twisted and turned like Busby Berkeley dancers through the crowded tables filled with Hollywood royalty. 1,200 movers and shakers and their guests, all white. I was the only colored actor in the room. I strained to get a glimpse of my co-stars from Gone with the Wind. We were up for 11 awards, so they had prime seating near the stage. Their tables were round and held anywhere from 10 to 24 people. I'd been led to the very back of the room, just outside the double doors leading to the kitchen. There was seating only for three here. A grudging, mean little message meant just for me. Don't be too full of yourself. Never, ever take up too much space.
Why is she here?
Someone muttered from the table across from me. I recognized the woman as a character actress from a silent movie. I wanted to shout, "I deserve to be here!" But I nodded pleasantly at her. Even those who tossed passive smiles my way didn't want me here. It was one thing to share a scene with them. There, I was subservient. But here, I was on their level, even if I was seated at the very back of the room. The sounds of the orchestra filled the club. The saxophones were playing. The show was beginning. Young Bob Hope was a good choice as host. He easily bantered and wisecracked his way through the program. Now it was 11:30, and with all the bubbly and cigarette smoke in the air, my heart was pounding. But then it turned into a full-on race when Faye Bainter walked to the podium. She'd won Best Supporting Actress for her performance as Aunt Belle Massey in Jezebel last year and was therefore presenting this year. And since that was the category I was nominated in, I strained to commit every word she uttered to memory.
"I'm really especially happy that I'm chosen to present this particular plaque," Faye began. I could hear the smile in her voice, even if she was so far away I couldn't clearly see her expression. "To me, it seems more than just a plaque of gold," Faye continued. "It opens the doors of this room, moves back the walls, and enables us to embrace the whole of America, an America that we love."
I scooted to the edge of my seat as her next words tumbled out.
"I present the Academy Award for the best performance of an actress in a supporting role during 1939 to Hattie McDaniel."
I'd won. I'd known I'd won, but hearing it made it real. Ferdinando, my very suitable date for the night, squeezed my hand and reached to help me slip off my white cropped ermine jacket. He was impeccably dressed, with an ankle-length black coat, slacks, and a white silk pocket square. As handsome as Ferdinando was, he was just a friend who often escorted me to events. My agent, Mr. Micklejohn, was clapping as if his name had just been called. There was no doubt he understood the magnitude of this moment. He'd given up his seat in the front to sit with me. He'd always looked me right in the eye and treated me with respect. He was one of the only white agents to represent colored studio actors in Hollywood. In fact, I was his sole colored actor. Now, he was smiling at me with joy. I stood as applause filled the room inside the Ambassador Hotel. As I stepped away from the table, I gave silent thanks to Ruby Berkeley Goodwin. Not only was Ruby my dearest friend, a wickedly funny, smart, wise woman who knew how to cut me down to size, she was the perfect secretary. She tucked me into this designer crepe turquoise gown and then efficiently had it customized for me. This dress, with its long sleeves, cropped jacket, tailored bodice, and cummerbund, was the perfect selection to make history in. I adjusted the gardenias and headband sitting atop my head, lifted my dress, and walked around the table next to me that was storing all the Oscar statues. I couldn't help but notice that the applause was tepid when Faye first announced my name, though it got louder as I approached the stage. I'm sure most people expected my fellow actress in Gone with the Wind, Olivia de Havilland, to win. Her performance as Melanie Hamilton, the sad, strong, loving wife of the rather drippy Ashley Wilkes, had been heralded in all the movie magazines as groundbreaking and heartwarming. We'd both been nominated for Best Supporting Actress, but my nomination as Mammy was the first time a colored woman had ever been nominated for this prestigious award. That's why no one expected me to win, except me. I knew long before the Los Angeles Times leaked the list of winners just before the ceremony. I knew I'd delivered a stellar performance in the role I'd fought so hard to get. As Mammy, I'd squealed and yanked on Vivian Leigh's corset so hard that she and I both nearly vomited. I knew the previous director, George Cukor, didn't want me because he thought I lacked dignity, so I had something to prove. I channeled my 31 years of stage and theater experience to deliver a solid, lovable performance. Since the awards part of the event started at 11 p.m., after the banquet dinner, the Academy gave the winners to the newspapers so they could get the papers out on the street by midnight. But the L.A. Times broke the embargo and published the names of most of the winners in an early edition before the banquet began, so almost everyone arriving at the Coconut Grove, which was the popular nightclub nestled inside the Ambassador Hotel, already knew Gone with the Wind would sweep the awards. Vivian would pick up the Oscar for her portrayal of Scarlett O'Hara, and I won for Mammy. Though we had the list of winners, everyone was reserved until the winners were actually announced, just in case. But with or without the Times, my heart knew the truth. I had won. And now that it was official, I wasn't about to let anyone or anything steal my joy. I held my head high and quickened my pace since it seemed like the entire room was waiting on me as I maneuvered my 5'2" frame down the narrow aisles and through the maze of tables covered with white linen. The who's who of Hollywood was here, dressed in the finest formal wear, floor-length colorful satin gowns with long V's in front and tuxedos with tapered collars and custom cuts. I nodded at Olivia, who looked like she was fighting back tears, yet still tepidly clapping. We'd been cordial with each other on set, but this was her first nomination, and history be damned, I knew she wanted to win. I smiled at Vivian in her stunning white Irene Lentz-fitted dress and white head wrap, her cigarette dangling from her hand. She returned my smile, though it never quite reached her eyes, as she was close to Olivia, and I'm sure she had been hoping for her friend to win. The two men sitting beside Vivian, Laurence Olivier and some man I didn't know, didn't bother with pretenses, as they sat stoically, without clapping. I gave my friend Clark Gable a special smile and a nod. Outside of my girlfriends, Clark was my dearest friend, and the only white man with such a distinction. He was the only white person who knew me behind the smile. Tonight, Clark was dapper in a midnight blue shawl-collared tuxedo jacket and boutonniere. His tapered mustache hugged his upper lip. His wife, Carol, was grinning like a 7-year-old who had just been given a puppy. And in her stunning purple silk gown, she glowed with celebration. Carol and Clark were in sync with their excitement. Really, they were in sync with everything. It was a miracle they'd found this kind of happiness in a town notorious for dismantling marriages. On the other side of Clark, my producer, David Oselznick, sat grinning hard. My win was a win for him as well. Though it had taken some convincing to get him to nominate me, his expression said he was glad that he had. As one of the top producers in Hollywood, he usually got what he wanted without effort. But he'd had to pull strings to get me into the Ambassador, since the hotel had a no-coloreds policy. My win made his fight worthwhile. I felt beads of moisture dampen my forehead as I marched toward the stage. Was it the journey across the room or my jubilant nerve?
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.